In our previous session, we were looking at DES data encryption standard. We looked at some variations of DES, that is double DES and triple DES. We've understood the weakness of DES and we looked at why DES is insecure. And we are now going to look at the next advanced encryption standard that has superseded DES, and that is called AES. AES is nothing but Advanced Encryption Standard, and this is the latest standard that is ruling the world right now. And almost any kind of encryption that's happening is happening using AES. But to understand AES, we need to understand certain basic mathematical concepts. And this session, we are going to try and understand all these basic mathematical concepts that will help us to understand Advanced Encryption Standard in depth. So these are the concepts that we are going to learn, and these concepts fall under abstract algebra. Some of you might have learned all these concepts in your schools, but let us again refresh these concepts. We will start with understanding what is a group, then we'll go to what is a ring, what is a field, and we'll understand finite fields. Finite fields are very important because when you talk about advanced encryption standard, advanced encryption standard is based on finite fields. So to understand finite fields, we need to understand group, rings, and fields. First, we'll start with group. So what is a group? A group is very simple. It is nothing but a set of elements. Let us consider A, B, C to be the set of elements. The set of elements can be anything. It can be a set of matrices. It can be a set of polynomials, a set of rational numbers, set of real numbers, set of integers, anything. So it's just a set of elements. And on this set of elements, we are just going to apply an operation. Let's consider addition. If I take addition and apply it on any two elements, and I should be able to achieve or satisfy all these properties by applying that operation on the set of elements, then I will say that is a group. So let me repeat this. It's nothing but a set of elements and an operation. We take this operation, and when we apply that on the set of elements, we need to satisfy all these axioms. So when all these properties are satisfied, you call those set of elements as a group. So let us take an example. Let us take the set of all integers. Set of all integers is denoted with a Z. And let's take set of all integers. So we can have a set like this, minus 3, minus 2, minus 1. So it's an infinite set, right? So it's 0, 1, 2 sets. It's a set of all integers. I'm just giving some numbers here. And we'll take this operation, addition. And we'll try and see whether these axioms satisfy this set. For any A, B belonging to this set, the element A plus B should also belong to this set. So if you take any two integers and add, the result 5 is also part of this set. So this is true for a set of integers. Each has an additive inverse. So what is this additive inverse? Say 2 plus minus 2 is equal to 0. So every element you take has an additive inverse. So this is also true for a set of integers. Associativity, that is A plus B plus C is equal to A plus B plus C. This is also true, right? 2 plus 3 plus 5, the result is going to be equal to 2 plus 3 plus 5. No matter how you do, addition is associative. So this also holds true for the plus operation on the set of integers. Identity, what is that? For every element, you take that element, you add a 0, then you're going to get the same element. This is true. 3 plus 0 is equal to 3. And 0 plus 3 is equal to 3. So there is an identity element that is also part of this set. So any two elements you take and you apply an operation, the result also should be part of that set. That is the most important criteria here. And when these properties are satisfied, we can call this set of integers to be falling under group. So likewise, you can take the set of rational numbers and the addition operation, it's going to satisfy all these properties. You can take the set of complex numbers and the addition operation. It's going to satisfy all these properties. Set of real numbers and all these operations, it's going to satisfy. So all these sets which satisfy these four axioms with respect to the operation addition, we can call them to be a group. There's one more thing. In abstract algebra, we don't have subtraction. Say we can take two numbers, say 5 minus 3. They say there is no subtraction, it is nothing but 5 plus minus 3. So they consider this to be an additive inverse. So there is nothing called subtraction here. Everything, even this kind of an expression, is treated as 5 plus minus 3. So that's why in our previous slide for the group, I was only talking about this operation, addition, though it is also applicable for subtraction. So here are some of the examples for groups. I told you set of integers equipped with the operation of addition is an example for a group. We have seen that. And here is one more thing. Z comma 0 satisfies all the axioms. That is, integers along with 0 satisfy all the axioms. So it is a group. We have seen that. This group is an abelian group since addition of numbers is commutative. So A plus B is equal to B plus A. So this axiom is satisfied. So you're going to say the group with all these axioms satisfied to be abelian group. So in the same way, Q represents here set of rational numbers, and R represents set of all real numbers. C represents set of all complex numbers. So when you take set of all these numbers and you apply this addition operation, you're going to have all these axioms satisfied. So we say all these sets come under the concept of groups in abstract algebra. Let's take an example. For instance, set of all natural numbers with the operation addition does not come under a group. So let's take set of all natural numbers. It starts from 1, 2, 3 and it goes right. It doesn't come under a group because these numbers don't have an additive inverse. Say you can't go and find 2 plus minus 2 that is equal to 0, right? Here you don't have minus 2. Minus 2 is not part of the set of natural numbers. So since the elements here, they don't have an additive inverse, we can say that all the natural numbers with this operation plus does not form a group. Okay. What is a ring? A ring is nothing but, again, it's a set of elements. And these set of elements can be anything, as told earlier. In our earlier group example, we are looking at only one operation plus. Here, these elements are also going to support another operation, that is multiplication. So when a set of elements are going to support these two operations and the result is also part of the set, then we can always consider that to be a ring. So what is a ring? It consists of a set equipped with two binary operations that generalize the arithmetic operations of addition and multiplication. Rings can also be considered as groups with additional features. For groups, we just support the addition operation, whereas in rings, the multiplication operation is also supported. So it means when you take two elements and you multiply, the third element is also part of the set. So multiplication property is also supported in rings. Let's take a look at the definition for rings. A ring R is a set on which two binary operations are defined, that is addition and multiplication, and it is denoted by plus and a dot. And with respect to addition operation, these axioms should be satisfied. These axioms are again from the group. So closure. So you take, again, let's take set of all integers. It contains both negative and positive numbers, right? So set of all integers. You take any two numbers and you apply addition operation, the result also belongs to the set. So that is closure. Inverse, every element has an inverse. 3 plus minus 3 is equal to 0. Associativity, yeah, it's also true for addition. And identity, yes, 0, when it is added with any element in the set, returns the element. And with respect to multiplication, the element should satisfy the associativity rule, that is a dot b dot c is equal to a dot b into c. So when this additional property is also satisfied by the elements, then we can say the elements, the set of elements, form a ring in abstract algebra. And there are certain things here, no need for a ring to be commutative with respect to multiplication. We don't expect a dot b to be equal to b dot a. This is not a requirement for a ring, and no need for it to have multiplicative inverses. So these are two properties that is not mandatory for a ring. And both multiplication and addition together should satisfy the distributive property. So for a ring, this should be satisfied. A dot b plus c is equal to a dot b plus a dot c, and a plus b dot c is equal to a dot c plus b dot c. So the distributive property, wherein multiplication and addition together combined, should be satisfied for the elements in the ring. So let's take some examples for rings. Set of all integers, yeah, they are satisfying all the properties, axioms with respect to multiplication and addition. So with respect to addition, they satisfy closure, identity, inverse, associativity. Even when you take two elements, say 3.2 is equal to 2.3, commutativity with respect to multiplication is also satisfied. So Z also forms a ring. Likewise, it applies for real numbers and complex numbers too. So these are examples for rings with identity. So here is one good example wherein a set is a group, but it is not a ring. Let us consider a set of elements wherein each element is a 2 cross 3 matrix. So it has 2 rows and 3 columns, something like this. So all the elements are matrices here. And these matrices do not form a ring. Why so? Because when you multiply a 2 cross 3 matrix, you cannot multiply a 2 cross 3 matrix with a 2 cross 3 matrix, right? You cannot do that. To multiply a 2 cross 3 matrix, we need a 3 by 2 matrix, 3 cross 2 matrix. So only we can multiply that. Say, let me tell you, if you have 1, 2, 3 and 4, 5, 6, your 2 cross 3 matrix, you can't multiply that with again another 2 cross 3 matrix. You need a matrix like this, that is 8, 9, 10 and 11, 12, 13. So only then you can take every element and then you can multiply and add it, right? So multiplication is not supported in the set of 2 cross 3 matrices. But addition is fine. When you add two cross 3 matrices, you're going to get a 2 by 2 cross 3 matrix. So that is fine. But whereas when you talk about multiplication is not supported. So the set of all elements that form a 2 cross 3 matrix is a group, but it is not a ring. So we have finished what is a group, what is a ring. Now let us take a look at what is a field. A field is again an extension of a ring. Say on a group, what all you applied? Addition and subtraction. And what you applied on a ring? On a ring you applied addition, subtraction and multiplication. So when the set of elements satisfy all these operations, it becomes a ring. Whereas when you talk about a field, it is like an extension of a ring too. What is the only operation that is remaining? So a field is nothing but it supports a set of elements that support addition, subtraction, multiplication and division. So if you have a set of elements, what is a field? It's nothing but again a set of elements. And what all operations are being supported? That is addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. If only three operations are supported, that is a ring. If only the first two operations are supported, what is that? That is a group. So now we are looking at a field wherein no matter even when you perform division, the result should also be part of the set actually. A field is a set on which addition, subtraction, multiplication and division are defined. But with abstract algebra, as I've already told you, there is addition, but there is no subtraction. We call that additive inverse. Say when we say 5 minus 3, we actually say it is 5 plus minus 3. So even subtraction is looked like addition here. Multiplication, we know what is multiplication. And we don't say division. Instead, we say multiplicative inverse. Say 3 divided by 5 is nothing but 3 into 1 by 5, wherein 1 by 5 is considered to be the multiplicative inverse. When we talk about field, a field should support all these operations, that is addition, additive inverse, multiplication, and there should be a multiplicative inverse for every non-zero element. Let's take an example for a field. Set of all rational numbers. What are rational numbers? It's nothing but two integers of the form a by b, where b is not equal to 0. So we all know what is a rational number. And they are commutative with addition. So a by b plus c by d is equal to c by d plus a by b. So rational numbers satisfy the first rule. They are commutative with multiplication. You agree that? Say a by b star c by d is equal to c by d star a by b, right? So commutativity is also satisfied, and rational numbers are commutative with respect to multiplication. All elements have a multiplicative inverse. So what is that? Say 2 by 3. What is the multiplicative inverse of 2 by 3? It's 3 by 2. So the final result will be 1. Product will be 1. And every element has a multiplicative inverse. That is the meaning here. And even this, the result, say this number, which we say is the multiplicative inverse, is also part of this set of rational numbers, right? If 2 by 3 is a rational number, 3 by 2 is also a rational number. So an inverse also is part of the set. That is very important. So when you take set of all rational numbers, all these three properties are satisfied. So we can say set of all rational numbers, that is denoted by Q, with respect to all these operations, plus, minus, star, division, that becomes an example for a field. Let us take another two sets which do not form a field. For instance, the set of all integers. Say you take an integer 5. What is the inverse of 5? It's 1 by 5. And 1 by 5 is not an integer, right? So this inverse is not part of the set. So it doesn't form a field. Likewise, 2 cross 2 matrices do not form a field because they are not commutative. So you multiply matrix A by B is not always equal to B into A. So that's why 2 cross 2 matrices do not form a field. And all matrices do not have an inverse too. So these are some of the examples for set of elements that do not form a field. So finally, we conclude that set of all rational numbers is an example for a field. And this set is actually infinite, right? Set of all rational numbers is an infinite set. The number of elements is infinite. Before going into finite fields, let us understand this very basic concept. Let's talk about set of all integers modulo 2, or else we can say set of all integers mod So what do you mean by set of all integers mod 2? It's like this. Your set contains all these elements, say 0 mod 2. You take any element in the set, we are going to do a mod 2 with that element. That is the meaning of set of all integers mod 2. And it is represented like this. So you take that set, what will have? The integer mod 2. Any integer, we have to perform a mod 2 of that integer. So when you go and perform a mod 2, what will be the output? Say you take 0 mod 2 is 0, 1 mod 2 is 1, 2 mod 2 is 0, 3 mod 2 is 1, 4 mod 2 is 0, 5 mod 2 is 1, 6 mod 2 is 0. So when you take a closer look at this, when you start performing a mod 2 with the set of all integers, the output is always going to be either 0 or 1. No matter how many integers you have in your set, the final output is going to be 0 or 1. So the set of all integers modulo 2 can be represented as 0 or 1. What is 0 or 1? This is nothing but representations given here. So finally, this leads to a 0 or a 1. Is that clear? That is what is called a set of all integers modulo 2. Likewise, let's take another example. Set of all integers mod 5. Again, I have given z mod 5 here. So what is 0 mod 5? 0. 1 mod 5 is 1. 2 mod 5 is 2. 3 mod 5 is 3. 4 mod 5 is 4. 5 mod 5 is 0. 6 mod 5 is 1. 7 mod 5 is 2. 8 mod 5 is 3. 9 mod 5 is 4. And 10 mod 5 is 0. So again, when you take a set of all integers mod 5, in this set, you'll have every integer wherein we take that integer and do a mod 5. And you can see a pattern here. So the numbers, the set has a value from 0 to 4. Again, the value starts repeating from 0 to 4. So when you talk about a set of all integers mod 5, you're just going to have these elements. So now we have taken two different sets. That is set of all integers modulo 2, and that is represented as 0 and 1. These are the two elements in the set, and set of all integers modulo 5, the elements in the set are nothing but 0, 1, 2, 3 and 4. So this is also a set. Now the question is this set a group, a ring or a field? Under what category you're going to classify these sets? That is the question. Okay, to classify something as a field, what is the important property? It should satisfy addition. So when you take addition and when you add two elements in the set, say you take any element in the set 3 mod 2 or 4 mod 2. When you add these two elements in the set, the result should also be part of the set. So either 3 mod 2, it is represented as 1. 3 mod 2 is 1 plus what is 4 mod 2? 0. So 1 plus 0 is 1. 1 is again part of the set. So it is A plus B. You get some result R. And A, B and R belongs to G, which is the set. So that is actually called closure. So likewise, I have taken another two elements, that is 5 mod 2, which is nothing but 0 plus 0. This is also equal to 0. Likewise, let us take multiplication. 3 mod 2 star 4 mod 2 is nothing but 1 star 0. The result is 0, which is again part of our set. Likewise, 1 mod 2 star 5 mod 2 is nothing but 1 star 1, which is again equal to 1, which is again part of our set 0, 1. So these operations, addition, multiplication, are actually supported in the set of integers mod 2. We have to check whether there is a multiplicative inverse. So what is this multiplicative inverse? According to the definition of a field, this multiplicative inverse should exist for every non-zero element. So we are only worried about non-zero elements here. So we will not worry about zero. So the multiplicative inverse of 1 is 1. In this set, for every non-zero element, we have a multiplicative inverse, and also addition, subtraction, multiplication is being supported here. So we can very well conclude that the set of all integers modulo 2 is a field. And we go one step further. When you take this set, how many fields you have here? You have only two numbers or two digits. So you have finite number of fields. That's what we understand. This set satisfies the properties for a field, and it also contains finite number of elements. So we can call this to be a finite field. So that's the definition of a finite field. It is nothing but is a field with a finite number of elements. We also understood that the set of all rational numbers, this is also a field, right? So all the operations plus, minus, subtraction, division was satisfied on the set of all rational numbers. But this set had infinite number of fields. Whereas in cryptography, we are looking for finite number of fields. We don't want infinite numbers here. So here, when you talk about this set of all integers mod 2, this contains finite number of fields, and also it is satisfying all the properties of a field. So such sets are called finite fields. So there is one theory that determines how many number of elements exist in a finite field. That's a theory that says how many number of elements will exist in any finite field. So that is this theory, that is number of elements in a finite field. This finite field is also called as a Galois field, based on the person who discovered this. And the number of elements in a finite field is always prime, or power of a prime. A finite field exists only for p per m elements, where p is a prime number and m is any positive integer. Let's take some example. We've already taken 2. What is this set of 2? It's nothing but 0 and 1. And 2 is a prime number. We can also represent this as gf 2 per 1, where gf is nothing but a finite field or a Galois field. So what is this gf? Gf is a Galois field, and it represents a finite field containing two elements, 0 and 1. For a set to be a finite field, the very important property is this number should be a prime number, and it can be raised to power of any positive integer. Here gf of 2 is nothing but 2 per 1 is nothing but gf of 2, that is this. Likewise, 5 is also a prime number, so it also creates a set of finite fields or Galois fields. And we can also represent this as gf 5 to the power 1. So how many elements you add in this set? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. For any finite field, if the element is a prime number, say if this is prime, then how many elements you will have in the set is nothing but 0 to 7 minus 1. We know 0, 1 is a finite field, and it can be represented as gf of 2. And how many elements you have? 0 to 2 minus 1. Likewise, for gf of 5, how many elements you have? 0 to 5 minus 1. The only criteria is this number should be a prime raised to the power of any positive integer. So finite field 81, and this can also be represented as 3 to the power 4. So there is a finite field of 256 elements, and this is represented as 2 per 8. So this we'll be using that in advanced encryption standard. So what is this 2 per 8? It is nothing but you can just think that to be 8 bits, right? 0000000. So we have 8 bits here. And what is 2 power 8? So we'll have 256 different values. And since it is G of 2, what are the possible values here? Either it can be a 0 or a 1. And since it's a finite field, what do you mean by a finite field? All these operations, plus, minus, division, multiplication, can be performed on these 256 elements. The result will also be part of this set. So it's nothing but 256 different byte combinations. That's it. That forms a set. And you call that to be a finite field because all these operations, when you perform on that set, you're going to get a result, which is also part of the set. And in advanced encryption standard, we'll be focusing on finite fields that is represented as GF 2 per 8. Is GF 12 a finite field? It is not a finite field because you can't represent 12 as power of a prime. You can say 2 square star 3, but this is not of the form P power M. So we can say that G of 12 will not form a finite field, will not form a set of finite field elements. Now we have to look at the difference between prime field and extension field. It's very simple. Say in Galois field of P, if M is equal to 1, we say that is a prime field. So GF of 2 per 1. So here M is 1. So we say GF of 2 to be a prime field. If M is greater than 1, then we say such fields are called as extension fields. I have showed you GF of 2 per 8. This is what we are interested in AES, right? So 2 per 8, when we have M to be greater than 1, we call that to be an extension field. Another thing that we have to understand here is we know that a set of integers will contain all integers, whereas a set of finite fields with P is equal to 2 will contain 2 elements. Whereas when you talk about a finite field, a set 2 per 8, it is made up of polynomials. It may be shocking to you, but that is what it is. The elements in this set, they are not integers, they are polynomials. So I hope you all know what is a polynomial, right? Polynomial is nothing but many terms attached together using the addition or subtraction operation. And in a polynomial, you'll have a coefficient and a variable. And these terms, so a coefficient plus a variable together makes a term. Like that, many terms will be attached together using a subtraction or using an addition or a subtraction. So that becomes a polynomial. In polynomial, you can have many number of terms, but the number of terms will not be infinite. So this set corresponding to G of 2 per 8, that is nothing but a set of all polynomials. We are talking about this finite field, right? This finite field will be having set of polynomials. So when I say 2 per 8, every polynomial will have 8 terms. So it can be plus, 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 like that. So a polynomial of 8 terms will make an element in this set. Likewise, I love 256 different elements. So we are going to work with polynomials in our advanced encryption standard. So that forms the basics, and we'll be again revisiting this later on. I hope you all have understood what is a group, what is a ring, what is a field, the properties of groups, rings, and fields, and what is integer modulo 2, the set of all integers modulo 2, and the set of all integers modulo 5. And we have seen how these two sets satisfy the properties for a field, And why we say these are finite fields? Because they have a finite number of elements and they satisfy the properties for a field. And then we looked at what is more important for advanced encryption standard. It is the finite field represented in the format 2 per 8. It just means you're going to have a polynomial with 8 terms for every element, and there will be 256 different polynomials like that. And when we apply the concepts of addition, subtraction, multiplication or division on these polynomials, we are going to get the result to be again part of the set, and it will also be a polynomial. So this concept we will be using that in advanced encryption standard. Thank you.